This Steve Jones Show podcast is now loading. The Steve Jones Show podcast is presented by Sunbury Motor Company, Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, and NIL Game Changers. Bringing you an in-depth look at Penn State sports and more. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. The Steve Jones Show is presented by NIL Game Changers, Sunbury Motor Company, Purdy Insurance, and Brewers Outlet. Now, from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Half hour brought to you by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. Imports, domestics, microbrews, the best selection of beer anywhere. Wine coolers, water, soft drink, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and out every day. Six great flavors of slushies. Pickle bar led by the barrels and the dills. Indeed, second to none. All of Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. All right. My good friend, the best out there, Tony Knopp. Too long, my friend. I always say that every time we start. Far too long.
It has been, but it's summertime. It's the fun part now.
Yeah, the fun part. I want to start, if you don't mind, with private equity.
Oh, boy.
I just did a story this week about Red Lobster, where Thai Union, and I'm not telling you anything you don't know, but Thai Union was brought in for a 49% share of Red Lobster, and they've now run it to bankruptcy because Red Lobster's ownership essentially ceded control of the day-to-day operation.
I think they closed 51 stores in the last 2 weeks, right? Is that what I just read? 51 locations?
Yep.
Yeah.
So how do you look at private equity with universities and athletic departments? And how important is keeping control moving forward?
So we have private equity investors here. I advise private equity funds regularly, so I know them very well. I know how they work. I know what their intent is, and I know what they try to do. There are so many kinds of private equity funds out there that it's kind of like comparing Penn State football to Grand Canyon, right, which is a private, for-profit Christian university in Phoenix. I mean, they're very, very different organizations in how they do things, but they compete in the same league. Private equity is kind of the same way. There's chop shop private equity, which is what happened with Red Lobster. You know, they come in, they try to benefit the bottom line. They make a lot of cuts. You know, the big names, if anybody has heard them, is, you know, the Toma Bravos of the world, people like that. What's happened with private equity is they've generally invested in businesses that we all understand, like Red Lobster and others, but they've really gotten into sports in the last 15 years. There are some private equity funds that are sports only, Bruin Sports Capital and others, and there's other really major ones that the listeners, bear with me on this one, you won't know who they are, but then when I start talking about what they do, you will know. So, you know, there's Arctos Sports Partners, there's Silver Lake, there's Sixth Street. Now, okay, those names don't mean much to you, but the New York Yankees do, the Dallas Cowboys do, Leeds United football team does, San Francisco 49ers do, right? These are the private equity funds that help acquire those teams or acquire the companies that are supporting those teams. And it has so much success in sports that they want to get involved on the university side because they see how fast it's changing. I mean, there was just a court decision a couple weeks ago where now the universities are allowed to pay their players.
Right.
And they see this as kind of a wild west, like this is all going to change and they want to be involved. And so it is going to be so fascinating if, you know, so the NFL, for example, is not allowing private equity to take control of a team. And the NBA was the first to do this. The NBA started allowing private equity in, I think, 2 years ago with the San Antonio Spurs. And you can hold part of the team, but you can't have a ownership interest in the team. They have a lot of rules about that. But the universities, they don't have a lot of rules yet. So I am dubious at best about this. When everything moves to for-profit all the time, how does that align with the charter for Penn State or with the charter for USC or for the universities that they're tied to? I just don't know how those can coexist.
And that's what I'm interested to see, because somebody that would be interested would be Redbird.
Yeah.
Redbird. Cardinal. Yep. Redbird is, yep, Jerry Cardinal. And LeBron James has shares in Redbird, I believe. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They have equity in the Penguins, the Red Sox, and AC Milan, if I'm correct.
And Liverpool, right?
And Liverpool because of the Fenway, the Fenway group.
Yeah, Fenway John partners. Mm-hmm.
With John Henry. So they have Liverpool, AC Milan. It seems that on the surface that they don't get involved in the day-to-day operation of what's going on.
When Redford private not yet, no.
Right, not yet. Now, they say that, now, this is Jerry Cardinal's quote, and this goes back to December when he spoke at the Sports Business Journal conference in Las Vegas. He feels that Redbird might be interested in 5 to 10 college programs. And when they asked about the value of Michigan, he said Michigan's value would be about a billion. That was his quote.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. When you're involved in private equity, what do they usually want in return?
So I'll keep it as simple as possible. Generally, businesses have different investment structures that they look for, right? Venture capital is kind of the entry level, high return, higher risk business, right? They're on one side of the spectrum. They're all the way to the left side of the spectrum, which is, and that's what we had originally. I'm going to invest in 18 companies. Three of them are going to be blowout good. Three of them might do okay, and the rest are going to go under. And that's okay with me because the three that are going to do well, one of them might do 100 times return on my investment. So I'll put in $2 million and I'll get $1 billion out of it in 10 years. On the far, far, far right side is bank lending, right, which is very low returns, super safe. I need to know every single thing there is to know about Steve Jones, and I'm going to know what you're spending on milk every month, and I'm hoping to get a couple of points. Private equity is more towards the bank side. So private equity is looking for, you know, generally private equity funds hold between 5 and 10 companies per fund, and they're looking for like a 20% return year over year. Right, they're looking for well-known businesses that are returning capital. And what they generally want to do is they see an opportunity to make that organization run better. Now, in the case of Red Lobster, they're saying, you got a lot of crappy stores that we need to close, and we're going to do that, and our profitability is going to go way up. And it's just, it's, you know, there's a lot of those private equity funds out there. It's awful. They lay a bunch of people off. It makes you think of Gordon Gekko on Wall Street. It's just the way it is.
Yes.
There's other private equity firms like Redbird, like Bruin, like Sixth Street, like those who look at this and they say, okay, well, we already have an ownership interest in a couple of other teams. And if we synergize our spend here, we can leverage the data analytics company we have an investment in to make Michigan a better school, to help them sell more tickets. We can get them a better deal on hospitality because at Sixth Street, we also own food and beverage through Legends Hospitality, right? Yep. And so that's what they're looking for when they do a deal like this. They look at a well-defined business like Michigan Sports, and they say, we're going to put money into it. We're also going to create some scale, right? And that's been... I don't want to go on too much of a tangent, but that's kind of been something that's been happening in college sports for a while.
That's right.
There's a company that I don't know if the listeners know of it, Learfield. What they do is they say, you know it.
Yes. Who do you think we've been with?
Good friend.
Yeah. Well, this is our last week with Learfield, by the way. So.
Oh, there you go. There's Learfield, there's JMI, there's Playfly, there's a number out there.
Penn State
and what they're doing is saying...
Penn State goes to Playfly on a Friday night.
Goes to Playfly. They go to Mike Schriever. I know Mike very well. He's a great he's a great guy.
Great guy.
I talk to him all the time. So what they're doing is they're saying, okay, if you go out there on your own, Penn State, and you try to hire a sales team to sell sponsorships both locally and nationally, it's going to be very difficult for you to get the scale that a national organization is going to have, where they're going to say, hey, we've got a database of 15 million companies. We're doing massive deals with large brands who want to do multiple teams at once, right? They don't just want Penn State. They want Penn State, and they want, you know, another mega team in each one of the regions. And so they create these efficiencies. That's what private equity is looking at with these universities. They're saying, if we can bring efficiency to these universities, they can make more money. At least that's their thesis.
Hmm. All right, so now, with the House ruling, what it'll do is it'll go back to Judge Claudia Wilken, and she's the one that has to eventually rubber stamp the settlement between all sides, which we all expect she will do. Starting in the fall of 2025, schools will have to start paying their athletes. The Penn State and USC number will be $22 million, right? Not 20, it'll be $22 million. And that's, I mean, and those schools will be able to handle this. So now let's take one step further. One thing that you don't see, that you see in the NBA, especially Major League Baseball, NHL, and in the NFL training camps, not in the regular season, training camps, sponsorships on the jersey.
Mm-hmm.
You know this very well. So give me an idea on Major League Baseball and the NBA, because these sponsorships on the jerseys, Vistaprint, Crypto.com, whatever it happens to be, are visible are visible on TV, but not to the fan in the stands. What is that worth potentially in college football based on what you know about the NBA numbers and the Major League Baseball numbers?
NBA and baseball, anywhere from $3 to $15 million a year, depending on what market you're in. Yeah. If you are in a major market, you can get $15 million. You can get Vistaprint on the Celtics jersey. You can get the Crypto's Spear, which is kind of an insider baseball deal on the Knicks. But there's still teams that don't have deals, and they've been trying for a while. I think the Texas Rangers just finally got a deal, and they're the world champions. I think the Devil Rays, smaller markets, they're having trouble. And so it's just going to become more and more haves and have-nots. I mean, you and I have been talking about this since 2018.
Yes,
right? We're on
that's
year
right.
7 of saying that it's a matter of time before college football is the Premier League. Like we're just following a already well-known, well-studied market, and guess who owns most of the teams in the Premier League? It's either private equity or outside interests, right? That's where we're headed with this. And what's it's scary for some schools and exciting for others. Like if you're SMU and you have super deep pocketed alumni, and you know you've kind of been on the outskirts of college football since the Pony Express in the 80s, then this is the best thing you've ever heard of, right? You've got oil money down there that you're ready to put to work to start competing. What I've been reading lately is how they're going to try to negotiate. Once she signs it into law, how do you start doing multi-year deals? How do you start doing multi-year NIL deals? How do you start locking players up? Because everybody is aware that the transfer portal is a thing, and they don't like it, and they don't like it for the sport. So how do we get to a position where signing day means something again, right? Because now what's happening is a lot of the signing day sponsors are saying, well, I don't care about signing day anymore because all you're doing is telling me where you're going to play next year.
Right.
And I don't know if you're going to be there beyond that. So this introduction of private equity, this introduction of jersey sponsorship, this introduction of new revenue streams is really leading us towards what you and I have been talking about for a long time, which is college football playoff, which we're finally here. That's kind of a UEFA Champions League. It's the same exact thing. And then you're going to have your divisions, and you can have your separate cups and bowls that go along that. People get terrified to say, well, then the Fiesta Bowl is not going to mean anything. But go tell everybody in Europe that the FA Cup doesn't mean anything.
Right?
I mean, Manchester United and City just dueled it out, and it was one of the most highly watched games we've had in the last 10 years.
Yep.
So I just think that's the way we're headed, and you have blue blood matchups, you know, October 12th, Penn State and USC, right? We're just headed that direction, and all the businesses around it are seeing it. History doesn't repeat itself. People do. And I think they're just looking at what's happening in these other sports and just replicating it, right? I think all these private equity guys are going, okay, well, look, here's what we did in the Premier League. Here's what we just did in the NBA. Here's what's coming in the NFL. What's next? Well, college football, of course.
That's why I feel administrators need to study this In other words, study the European football model. Study it. That way you can put together, if you decide to go private equity, you can put together a deal that works for the private equity firm and for you.
Right.
Right.
Well, here's what's terrifying about it is if you look at what happened in European football, at least in England, which is the biggest league, the Premiership, is the top teams got out in front of it and just said, look, you know, we have loyalty to the rest of the teams in the FA, but not really.
Yeah.
You know, it's Everton, Arsenal, Chelsea, you know, those teams. That's where Penn State and USC sit right now, right?
That's right.
I mean,
that's right.
So at some point, who's going to – this isn't a collectively bargained agreement like you see in the pro leagues where people are going to look out for franchises. They're not. This is going to be a haves and a have-nots. And if you're a team that's sitting on the line of a have and a have-not, and I'd use an example locally, UCLA.
About to bring that up.
Relatively locally for you guys. Pitt.
Yep.
What do you do if you're Pitt right now? Right? You're not a blue blood anymore, but you're on the line, and now you're in trouble because this is going to split into Group of Five and majors, college football playoffs. Mm-hmm. Maybe one of them will get to come play in like they do in the Champions League. You know, maybe this is the time you look at private equity. I mean, if you look at UCLA, they had a $106 million deficit. That's why they did the Big Ten deal.
That's right.
Right? They had to do the deal.
Yeah.
They were broke.
Right.
And they want to compete on a national level. So this all has happened before, right? I'm not trying to bore anybody, but if you look at, like, Leeds United, for listeners who don't know what Leeds United is, Leeds United was one of the premium sports teams in the world. They were a multi-time champion of Europe, and in 2003 they had an owner who was kind of like Pitt, kind of like UCLA. They went all in to try to get to the UEFA Champions League and get the £20 million that go with it, and they didn't get in. Declared bankruptcy, sold twice. Leeds fell all the way down to Division Three, which would be like the Boston Red Sox playing in an independent league in Cape Cod. And then they eventually got their way back to, not in the second league, they were in the Premiership last year. They lost in the playoff last week to get up. But if you're sitting there and you're an administrator at a school like West Virginia, at UCLA, at, I mean, I hate to say it, I mean, yes, you have the conference looking up for you, but Illinois in football.
I agree.
Right? You're looking at this and you're terrified. You're saying, well, this is not a good time for us to be down as a program because this great divide is happening. And
well, I'll give you the great divide. Hey, USC can afford the $22 million per year.
Easily.
UCLA can't.
Cannot. No,
and okay, Pitt can't. Illinois, I don't think, can. And here's the other part. Let's remember, UCLA has to give $10 million of what it's doing to Cal Berkeley for three years.
Yeah. And Cal has essentially given up on big-time college sports. Cal and Stanford have both said, we're not going to retrofit our stadium. Stanford, you know, this is out west, so I don't know how much they get paid attention to back east, but Stanford's a perfect example of, you know, Stanford Stadium seated 95,000 people. Now it seats 35. They still don't sell it out.
Yeah.
They don't care, and they're not going to. They decided we do Olympic sports. We're not interested in big-time college football. And that's the concern is if you're UCLA, you're saying, okay, I've got to give $10 million to Cal. I've got the money. I've got protection from the Big Ten, but I'm taxpayer-funded in a state that doesn't want to give any more money to sports.
That's right.
So it's just going to be so fascinating. And if you're a private equity brand, though, that's the logo you're looking at. You have your blue bloods. You have Penn State. You have Whiskey. You have Michigan, right? Wisconsin is the most highly attended college sports town in the world. I saw Penn State was in the top 10. But they sell out everything, right? That's a sure thing bet. But there's also going to be investors that look at this and say, okay, here's a brand that could be national in UCLA. They're hurt. I get a pretty good deal here.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll put $22 million, but I'm going to take some control here.
Yeah. Oh, they can lowball them. They can lowball them and get involved. Penn State has, for brand name, second highest attendance in the country. And from 2016 to 2023, 241 million viewers, which in that time frame is number six in the country. I mean, they're attractive for people who want to get involved.
Yes. That's a surefire bet. And those are the kind of brands that Jerry Cardinal's going to look at. He's going to look at those brands and say, I want Penn State, Michigan, right, Alabama, Texas. I want surefire money. You know, it's, and we've seen that happen across sports in general, where things have just been undervalued, right? You know, somebody looks at the Golden State Warriors at $420 million in 2012, and now they're worth $6.5 billion, right? It's an undervalued asset. That's what they're looking at. But then you're going to have those private equity shops we were talking about that are going to say, okay, where is there a brand that used to be a national brand that we can put some money into and maybe make a national brand again? Pitt fits into that, right?
Yep.
UCLA fits into that. You're looking for programs that are a little bit down right now that maybe their great days are behind them. You know who the number one poster child for all this is going to be? If I gave you a guess, you'd guess in a second, but it's Miami. 100% it's Miami. Yep. Right? They are going to be the first team to get a ton of private equity money and get all that clout behind them. But it's going to change the sport completely. And it's due time, but I just think it's going to be really ugly for the next 5 to 7 years. Nobody knows what the rules are. There's going to be a lot of cheating because there's no central organization until eventually we all accept it. It's the college football playoff who is at the end of the line of all of this that's going to litigate from the back.
Yeah.
Right. And essentially say, like, look, if you break the rules, we're not going to let you play. And this is where it is. And that's what UEFA does for club soccer. UEFA says, if you break the rules, you can't. Like, for example, the new owner of Manchester United also owns Nice in France.
Yes.
Nice and Manchester United are supposed to play in the Europa League next year, and you can't have two teams in the Europa League, so he's going to have to figure out what happens. Right? These are rules we don't have in place. If Jerry Cardinal puts money into Penn State and Michigan, there's no rule or guideline that stops Penn State from playing Michigan on the field tomorrow.
That's right. That's right. But the next key part to me, okay, most people want to stay away from anything congressional with this, because the government, let's be straight, the government isn't really good at running a lot of things, especially if it's not something they're used to doing. I mean, you know, it's not a sports entity. I mean, I think that's a fair statement.
Well, it's 100% fair.
But what the NCAA does need from them to at least have some relevance and all, if they can get an antitrust exemption, that would give them the power to negotiate a deal with the players on collective bargaining to put structure around this. Would that be fair?
Yeah. I don't think it would just be fair. I think it would be better for the sport.
Yes.
I mean, so if you look, again, Premier League, probably the most mature, non-collectively bargained agreement there is the Premier League, right? Like, we could point to the NFL. That is by far the most mature. Their collective bargaining is the best in the world. But we're miles from that in the university system in the NCAA right now. But at least there you have multi-year deals, and there's a transfer window. There's two transfer windows, just like there are for universities. But people don't generally do transfers until the year before their contract is up, and sometimes there's a trade between the organizations. Right? We don't have any of that protection in college sports right now. If you're Quinn Ewers and you go to Ohio State, you can transfer to Texas next year. If you're Joe Burrow and you're at Ohio State, you can transfer to LSU next year, right? Mm-hmm. And these things happen, and that's fine. But is that what's good for the sport? Do people just want to watch one kid come in 1 year? I mean, I hate to sound like the old man, but I liked watching kids grow in the program. Yeah.
Me too. You are the greatest. I mean, that was a half hour that felt like 3 minutes.
We'll do it again soon.
We'll do it again soon. I hope you are well, my friend. And by the way, tell Pete Arbogast that Penn State's now part of the Play 5 family, all right?
I love it. I'll do that.
Okay. Thanks so much, Tony.
Okay, talk soon.
Tony Knopp. Man, that went like that. Sue will be on next to refute all this. His first question is, what did they talk about?
Party time, game time, or just fun time. Doesn't matter what time it is, because it's Brewers Outlet time. The Beverage Supermarket has the area's largest beer selection. Imports, microbrews, ciders, and domestics. Pick from over 100 ice-cold 12-packs and dozens of 24-ounce singles. Soda, snacks, hot sauces, fresh roasted peanuts. Make it one-stop party shopping, and don't forget the pickle bar. So whatever you're celebrating or just doing it up, Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street, Sunbury, wants to see you. And thank you for your years of patience. patronage.
You want a unique way to display your brand. You need a team of seasoned experts to work with. You want to reach customers who buy. You want NIL Game Changers, a versatile consulting agency powered by former student athletes and coaches who work as NIL sports agents. NIL Game Changers will help you build powerful relationships with customers through compelling stories, with student athlete influencers as your leading edge. Finally, we'll equip you with the right media to drive your success home. NILGameChangers.org, building meaningful relationships with your customers.